What is DevOps? Everybody has the question, like, you know, is it a DevOps? Is a technology or using some technology we are building the DevOps? No. First thing is DevOps is a methodology. It's not a technology. What does DevOps represent? From the name itself, it's two different things. Dev stands for development and OPS stands for operations. If you work in IT world, like, you know, we will not call it as operation team. What exactly this operation team belongs or whom they belong? They belongs to a team called a deployment team. If you work in IT world, people will talk about development team, testing team, and the deployment team. So here the deployment team, we are calling it as operation team in the modern world or modern technology, which they are calling it as. So DevOps, development with the operations. So if I give a real time example, usually in any project you would be seeing, a developer would be saying, like, you know, I have done my work and it's working in my local. See, this is my unit test proof and please take the build to a production. Now the operation team comes. So the developer job is done. He said, like, you know, things are working in my local. Now I'm done with my work. So the operation team takes that code and go and deploy in the production or any staging environment. And immediately you will hear saying, like, you know, the things are not working. So always there is a fight going between the development team and operation team, saying that everybody has did their job, but still the application is not working. So always there is a barrier between this development team and operation team. Now a guy come or the new methodology has come combining these two things. So that is called DevOps. So hereafter, no more it's called a development team and operation team. So combining these two, we have come up with something called a DevOps in the market. He's a guy or you are the guys who are participating today. You are the guys who is going to do this job. So you have a question. I mean, in that case, am I going to do a coding or I'm not a developer. I don't know coding or I don't know which technology they are building the code. Yes, of course, you don't need to know the coding or which technology they are building the product. So DevOps is a guy who is not doing a development or who is not completely doing the operation things. Like, you know, he is with the configuration, he's combining all this together and put it in a right cycle. So before that, before coming into DevOps, there is nothing called a life cycle here. Like, you know, how the things will go. As Ganesh has set the expectation in the previous slide, it's a waterfall model. So one has to do one job, then it will go for other things. But now here we comes, like, you know, let's go one by one step here. So the first thing, as I said, like this round belongs to a development team and this round belongs to an operational team, which is a deployment team. So it's work like this. So the first thing, like, you know, what is happening? First thing in the project, what we are doing, we are going to do some planning. How are we going to deliver or how many user stories or what we are trying to deliver? So those things would be done by planning. So it's here majorly project management team or business analyst or product owner sits here and they will do all this relational stuff. Once it's done, the immediate step starts work on is like called a developer. Developer will work on this green block. He's a developer who start building that prototype or like the real application. Once this has been done, like we'll move on next. So in DevOps, once the developer has did the coding, the next thing comes is it has to be verified by somebody, right? Like since the developer will do unit testing, but it has to be certified by some testers. So the testing teams will come into picture. So they are gonna verify like whatever the developer has did it. Once they have verified and they have certified and they said, like, you know, this build is perfectly fine, take this build to a production. So now what comes? We are doing a package. How are we going to do a package? We will see in detail or I'll show you a demo as well, how to do all these things. Like every step over here is we are going to show a demo and we will see in more detail. Just bear with me with the flow for now and we will see in more detail shortly. Once the package has been done, then we are releasing it for some environment. How are we releasing it? We'll see the tools later. Once we have released, we are going to do the configuration. Where we are doing the configuration? This configuration is done in the server. So when I say a configuration in the server, what exactly it means? You need to say like which OS you are going to use in the server, which how much GB of disk space you are going to allocate, how much GB of RAM you are going to allocate, etc. Everything counts on the configuration part. Once this is done, the project would be successfully deployed in the server, right? Once it has been successfully deployed, the application is keep running and the end user will see the product. There, the other things comes monitor. What is monitor exactly? It means monitor is like we need to monitor the application. If in production, it's not like a guy who will sit in the production server and we keep watching what's happening in the production, right? It's not the way. Like, you know, now we are in a 2020 and we are in an automation world. So everything has to be automated. Like if something goes wrong in the production, immediately has to be notified by email or through phone call or text messages or chatbot. A lot of features are there to intimate like the corresponding team to look into the issue. So having said that, like, you know, there were four terminologies which majorly plays in the DevOps. One is called continuous integration. What is continuous integration? The planning and the development of things is called continuous integration. And the continuous delivery is like a testing and doing the package is called continuous delivery. Then the continuous deployment. So this is called CI, this is called CD. These two are the major players in the DevOps world. So everywhere you could hear something called CI CD, you may hear something called pipeline as well. Again, guys, bear with me. We are gonna see in more detail what this is about. Then followed by operations. Like what is operation? The configuration and the monitor is managed by the operation teams. So if I say it in a more way, what is DevOps now? It's combining the development team with the operation team, or it's not only with the people, it's not only grouping the development team and the operation team, and also we have followed the process, right? We have followed a certain process or life cycle to achieve the project in a good time frame. So that's where this explanation talks about. It's union of people, process, and products to enable the continuous delivery. Let's move on. So the next thing which we are going to see about why DevOps and what all the benefits we are achieving with the DevOps. So the first benefit you could see is like here, the improved monitoring and the quicker service recovery. Since, as I said, like, you don't need to physically, somebody needs to monitor every step. Like there is an automation process or automation tool which would be keep monitoring what's happening within the whole process or within the whole lifecycle methodology. The next thing comes is like a quick turnaround of change requests. Let's say any change request comes, like, or let's take like a, since we are near to Christmas, let's say Rogers or Bell, they are rolling a new offer. Do you think like how long it's gonna take in the market if they want to roll a new offer? It's been like, you know, for us, we see it in a day, but what they are doing it, like they are working for an N number of days to roll out a single offer. I mean, before the DevOps, but with the DevOps, everything is super fast. So they can release a new plan within a day. Everything goes good, right? Then the next thing which we are seeing is like, we already seen like, it's basically combining the people, development team, testing team, operational team, project manager teams and everything. Then followed by continuous delivery. So it's keep delivering, the processes keep flowing, like, you know, from the beginning to end, it would be keep flowing. And the reduced operational costs. Why we are calling it as reduced operational costs? Since this is one step process or one time process. Once you have spent some initial amount of time to set up the complete whole life cycle, after that, you don't need to spend a lot of time. You just need to do a maintenance activity. Let's say like initially with the project, we may be having n number of resources. After that, like, you know, there would be a more of maintenance. So that's where the more cost saving is happening with the DevOps. That's where the entire world is more towards the DevOps. Then followed by improved software quality. As I said, like we'll see in detail what all the software quality tools. So you may have a question now, like, you know, since I could see the audience now as a tester, fresher, developer, and program manager, you may have a question like, you know, I'm a program manager. Am I eligible or am I really need to learn the DevOps or where I exactly sits here? As I said, like, he's a guy, like a DevOps is a guy or is a methodology who is going to cover entire thing, like starting from the planning until you deploy and monitor, everything is happening as part of the DevOps. So it's not only for a developer or it's not only for the deployment team. It's for everybody. That's having said that, everybody has to learn the DevOps, seeing the market picture now. So let's move on. The next one. What are the tools available in the DevOps? Or what are the tools available in the existing market? So it's the same picture again. So it just given some information on top of it. So we have something called initially the planning phase and the coding phase. So if you would have worked in IT, like we would have heard a terminology is called a Git, SVN, TFVC, a lot of things. It's basically a Git repository. It's basically a repository to hold your code. So when the developer did the code change, they have to store it somewhere. That's nothing but Git. And Jira and Confluence. Confluence is mainly used for earlier days, like everywhere that we were preparing a Word document and the document would be sending it for approval, all these things. With the Confluence, everything is like, you know, just an URL page. Over there, the LLD or high level documents or low level documents, everything is being updated and it would be sent for review. Everything is through the process, not with the document. Since the document, somebody may not take the latest code or latest document. Somebody may not have the latest document. With that, we'll be losing a lot of things. So with that, like there is also market standard tools available. So I really don't want to go each and every tool in detail, but I'll just give a overview like here. So Git, it is basically like a to store your code base. And once you have did your code, let's say like you have did your code through Angular. Let's take one example as an Angular, as a front end. In the back end, you would have did the code with Java. Then what exactly we are going to do? Once you have did the coding, so Maven is used to build the code. When we say build the code, it's gonna create a package or create a var file or zip file or tar file. Using some... it's a framework. We are going to build that files for ready for deployment. Since here in the GitLab, you may be having thousands of files and each file is having hundreds or thousands of lines of code. Is it a good practice or like, you know, can we take this all this code, like all this packages and go and deploy in the server? No, it's not. Even server will not understand what is this many files are coming or what these many codes. So instead, what we will do, whatever the code changes developer has did it here, it would have done by multiple developers. We would just create it as one var file or zip file. That would be done by the build tools. There are a lot of build tools available in the market. So for just for today's example, I have put few over here, the SDT and Maven. Maven is used for a Java build framework. Then once the build has been done, we need to do the testing, right? The testing would be done by a lot of open third-party tools were available, Cucumber, Selenium, JUnit, etc. So here we have given something called Selenium and the JUnit for our testing. Right after that, Jenkins, which is basically one of the before DevOps has come into picture or before the cloud related things has come into picture, Jenkins are playing a vital role on this automation deployment. So here what Jenkins is doing the release, followed by the deployment would be done by Docker, AWS or Azure, any technology using that, you can do a deployment. Right after that, the operational related things would be done by Chef or Ansible or Kubernetes. We will see in all details about what these tools are or like what is those exactly does. Once it has been, the operational or the configuration, these tools are basically the configuration related tools. Once you have this configuration related, then followed by that, you need to monitor your application. On the production, you need to monitor. So there are a lot of external tools, Nagios, Splunk, and Datadog, which will be keep monitoring your application. If anything goes wrong, immediately it will raise an alarm to the corresponding team and they will get a notification for the same. Now, you have a question now. With this DevOps and which we are talking about, since I said like these are the most commonly available tools and we have a lot of plenty of tools. Now we have a question. If I want to become a DevOps expert, should I need to learn all these tools or should I need to be an expert of all these tools? To answer for this question, we'll go to the next slide. So that's where we are now. Like, you know, we don't need to really need to know all these tools. So we could see, but it's good to have a knowledge on some of the tools. But this is the open standard, right? Like once we move, that's where we are getting into the framework now. Now we are seeing the next thing is called Azure DevOps. How are we overcome all these tools? Instead of learning all these tools, how Azure has come up for us, like to know, build all these things automatically together. So with this approach, what the DevOps guy earlier was doing, he has to manually take the code from there, and he has to put it put it in the Maven and to build the file. Once he has did, he has to take that file and put it in the Selenium to test it. Once it has been tested, take that file and go to the Jenkins, put it the file in the Jenkins, and take that file again, go and do the deployment in the server, then take that file again. It was like more of manual process, right? And using these many tools, we are achieving all these things. Now, the next thing which we are gonna see is about Azure. With Azure DevOps, how we are overcome all these things and how to integrate all these things, since Azure has already integrated all these things together. So with what we are gonna do now, we are just need to do configure between these two things, like go to build and build to test and build to deploy, something like this. So next we'll see about why Azure DevOps. Since we have seen so far like what is DevOps and what are the benefits of the DevOps, now we could see Azure DevOps. With the Azure DevOps, let's say you set up a new environment or new server. So what do you need to do? You need to install the database. Of course, you know, like how much time consuming to install the database, to install the virtual machine or install the OS, everything is time consuming, right? Like, you know, and even the nobody wants like, or the project don't really needs like, you know, the deployment taking months and months to complete all this process. With cloud, what has happened? Everything is a one-step, one-click process. So once you get into the Azure cloud, you will see a service called SQL database. Once you just click on it, automatically the SQL database would be created in the cloud. Now you have a question, do I really need to use a cloud? No, we have something called on-premises also. With the on-premises, you can go for it and you can install whatever you want. The hybrid is nothing but combining the cloud and on-premises. Let's say some customer may say, I'm more interested to use cloud related servers, but I don't want my database to be in the cloud. I mean, since the customer may, or let's say a customer, let me give an example. The customer is in government organization. So the government may say, I wish to use the cloud, but I don't want the database to sit in the cloud, since I may feel like since Azure is Microsoft is owning, so they may see the data at any point of time. For that, they may say like only the database, they want to keep it on premises. Remaining things, everything is on cloud. So that's this something called hybrid. So quickly, I'm summarizing here. So on premises is nothing but you have your own dedicated setup on your data center, which means you have your own database, you have your own server, etc. And cloud is nothing but everything you are moving under a cloud. Everything under the cloud, we have all these things and you are just using that without doing any initialization or anything. You just pay to the Azure and they are managing all these stuff. You don't need to manage all these things. If anything goes wrong, it's their responsibility to bring it back. The hybrid is something like combining cloud and on-premises is nothing but hybrid. So that's where you could see called Azure and the on-premises here. So this is the more good benefits of the Azure DevOps, using the Azure DevOps, since all these things are in place, you don't need to manually go and install all these things or set up all these things. So next we will see about what are the DevOps services available. What are the DevOps, Azure DevOps services available here? There were five major features available in the Azure DevOps. One is Azure Board, and the other one is Azure Repo. Azure Boards are nothing but if you worked in an Agile project or if you heard something called Agile or Scrum methodology or Kanban methodology, these were the Azure Boards where you could always see like your the user stories, sprints and everything, etc. here. Azure Repos, it's nothing but a repository. It's basically using the Git repository as a master source, and it also uses TFVC as well. Then the next thing comes pipelines, Azure pipelines. We will see in detail what is pipeline and how to write a pipeline as well. The next thing comes artifacts. How exactly the artifact works, or what is artifact is nothing but, as I said, like after a build, once you have built a WAR file or any file, that end product of that WAR, the end product is called WAR file, right? Before you deploy into a server. So that is nothing but Azure artifacts. That WAR file, you can call it as Azure artifacts. The next thing comes is Azure test plans. Here is the place where we can have the manual testing, automation testing, everything over the reports. You could see everything can be maintained or managed it over here. So now if you learn all these five key features, then you can call yourself as I'm an Azure DevOps expert. Now we will see in detail how these five are interconnected and how this five is getting used with a real-time example. Next thing, you could see here, this is the Azure DevOps tools and project lifecycle. This is a real example which we have prepared for you. How does it work? Let's say tomorrow a new customer comes, or Rogers or Bell, if you want to take it as an example. So the customer comes with a requirement. This, they may say like, I want to build a front-end application, and which has to show me like what all the offers are there, what all the plans are there, some anything. Like the customer may come with a requirement. The next thing, who is going to get the requirements from the customer? It's always the business analyst and the end-to-end solution architects or the product ones, right? So once they get the business requirements, they start putting into the Azure board. So this green symbol represents the Azure board. So they will basically, all the requirements, they will break down and they will create it into the work planning in the Azure boards. So they will break down each requirement and they will create it under the Azure boards. The next thing comes like, you know, the product owners will start look for sprint and capacity planning. What does it mean? Sprint means as like in the agile way of working, a sprint stands for like, we have some specific target to achieve in some time. So sprint usually runs between 2 to 8 weeks. So in some companies, the sprint, they may go for 2 week sprint or 3 week sprint, up to 8 weeks, they can go for it. So within the 2 weeks, let's take an example as a 2 week sprint. So within the 2 weeks, they have some certain feature they are targeting and they try to deliver. So that's where the engineering team starts working on the sprint planning and the capacity planning. Capacity planning represents this sprint in within 2 weeks, they are trying to deliver something. So they need to look for how many developers is going to work on that, how many testers is going to work on that. So that's where after three, it's getting breakdown. Like the next task is start working with the developer. Again, 3.1 goes here. So this represents, if you remember the previous slide, so this is Azure board, this is Azure test, and this is Git. So Git is mainly used by the developer. This test plan is used by the tester, and this would be used by the project managers or the other business analyst. The step four now is developers starts taking some of the back, some of the items or the work items from this boards, and he will start work on it. Once he has delivered it, like he will commit the changes into the Git repository. How he is doing the code, he is doing with the Visual Studio. So this represents Visual Studio. Visual Studio is again one of the Microsoft certified IDE, integrated development environment tool. As like if you would have heard a term called Eclipse, IntelliJ. So those were the IDE, open source IDE, which you can use it for building the code. So now every world is more towards like a Visual Studio, since it's more user friendly to build a, any code base, both front end, back end, or anything, anything you can build it with, use the, with the help of Visual Studio. So you developer sits here and open a Visual Studio, and he will do the, he will take one item from here and he will start work on it. Once he has worked, he will commit the changes into the Git repository. He'll commit the changes into the Git repository. Then step four and five done. Once the developer has finished his work, what is the next step? Next step comes, this is Azure pipeline. So what does Azure pipeline does? Like, as I said, like it's a CI and CD, continuous integration and continuous deployment. So basically, there are a lot of frameworks which will go on, take the code from the Git repository here, whatever developer has committed or whatever they have committed. So a framework will, or agent will go on, take the code from here, and it will start building the package. So build can be done by a lot of tools like Maven and a lot of things. So building the codes is happening as part of that process. Once it has been built, we have to deploy it. The next task is to deploy it. So once that the code has been built, you can keep it in the artifacts. So the most common reusable things or those things can be kept it in the Azure artifact. See here, you could see something called NPM and Maven packages. So using those things, we are building the package and we are keeping it in the artifacts. Then step 7 is like once you have created the build or basically you created a var file, that var file or zip file has to be deployed somewhere. How are you going to deploy it? This is your process. 7 is going to deploy it in the testing environment. The first thing what you are going to do is you are going to deploy it in the testing environment, which means here developer has done and he did the unit testing. All these things has been done. Now we are giving it to a testing team to do a certification or to certify that the code is valid. So the step number 8 goes here. So 7.1, we deployed in the testing environment. So the step number 8 comes, build. Once the build is deployed, tester start testing it, right? Like they have to start doing the testing either with the manual way of testing, or if they have the automation in place with the automation framework, they will do the automation testing. If the tester is satisfied with the build, he may say like, yes, there were no issues. You go ahead with the build. Then after 9.1 comes, we will deploy into a UAT, user acceptance testing. This acceptance testing would be done by the mostly would be done by the customers or collaboration with the customers and the testing team. This is the most important part of the testing, since this is the place where we are certifying to take to a production. Let's assume a case like in the step number 9, tester says like, you know, I could see a lot of issues with the build. Whatever the build we have gotten, we are facing a lot of issues and I'm not certifying this build to a production, to a UAT. So what will happen? Again, we'll go back. Again, tester will raise a defect here. So that's where this process, he will go back here in the Azure board and he will raise a bug here. Once the bug has been raised, the developer will start take that bug from the Azure board and he will start work on it. Once he has done, he will again push the code into a Git. It will go for a build. We are going to take a build. It's getting deployed into the test. So the test again, test number, the tester comes and he's doing a testing. Again, if it's failing, what is happening? Again, the same process is going to follow. So Azure board, developer do a coding, push into the code repository, pipeline will run. Everything is automated. Like, you know, here only place like, you know, developer is, tester is creating a bug and developer is doing a coding. All these things are automated. So here, nobody is touching it. Like from step 6, 7, 7.1, all this are automated, even from 5 onwards. So let's assume a case like, you know, tester has certified and everything goes good. So 9, he certified. So we deployed in UAT. Then who is going to do the testing? So the business users, as I said, like it's a collaboration of customer and the testing team would be doing this testing. So the business users start testing in the UAT environment. Then if there is any defect, again, they will go back here. So the UAT users will raise a defects in the Jira. The process is keep continuing like this. Let's assume a scenario, it has been passed. Test number 11 has been passed. There is no defects. So the UAT has been successfully signed off. Then finally it will get deployed into the production environment. So you could see here, this is, you can see this picture in a two different way. One is how the end-to-end process are working in a IT world, starting from gathering the requirements from the customer until to get deployed into the production. The second thing which we are seeing is here is like a what all, how our Azure services are interlinked and where exactly our all our Azure services are connected out over here. See, our Azure services are playing a major role here. This is step first service, second service, third service, fourth service, and this is fifth service. So all our 5 services is covered. So as I said, like if you learn all this 5 service, you would be an expert in the DevOps. If you have any questions, always feel free to ping in the chat. Like we would be happy to take it. Let's move to the next one. Let's see in detail about what is this Azure boards or what are all these services? What exactly, what are the key features sits in this Azure features? Any questions? Okay, guys, if you guys have any questions, you can unmute yourself and you can ask for it. Since almost we have covered the huge topic, I wish to hear something. Sorry, somebody is talking. Can you be a little bit louder?
No, Ganeshan, we are good. Please go ahead.
Perfect. Good to hear. I could take it in the two ways. This, one way is everything what we have explained so far is understood. The other way is it may be so hard to follow as well. Yeah, I'm happy to hear both the cases, and if we need, we can go in detail as well. So next, let's move on. Let's see about each service in detail. How this each services work in detail. The first service is gonna be Azure Boards. The first service is going to be Azure Boards. How the Azure Boards works? So there are five key features sits in the Azure Board as well. One is work items, boards, backlogs, sprints, and dashboards. So if we are not talking, can we please go in mute? We could help others to. Thank you for your understanding. Okay, so the Azure Boards has these things. So as I said, in Azure Boards, every item is considered as a work items. So whatever the project is planning to do, again, guys, may I request whoever is on unmute yourself on mute. Let me try to mute them. Just give me a minute, guys. Is it Prashant? Okay, let me mute everybody. Seems like a lot of guys. Okay, I hope I have muted everybody. Let's move on. The next thing which we are seeing about Azure Boards. So every item is considered as, or whatever the project is planning to deliver something, everything is considered as one work item. So they will create the business analyst or the product owners will create an N number of work items. And using boards, what does a board represents? So let's assume a team, you have a front-end team, back-end team, and a deployment team. So every team is gonna have one board. In that board, they are gonna have their task. See, when the product owner creates a work item, he will create a task for the front-end team, back-end team, or middleware team, etc. But we have to differentiate ourselves, who is gonna do what? So in the board, we can create a board specific. I just gave an example here, board can be specific to a team. It's up to you or up to our understanding, we can create a board for any purpose as well. So that's where the board exactly represents. Then the thing comes is backlogs. Backlog is what is backlog? So every items is considered work, whatever the work items you consider, everything is considered as a backlog, which means if you work in an agile project, each sprint, you have a sprint here. So each sprint, let's assume it's a 2-week sprint. In 2 weeks, you're trying to deliver something. You're trying to deliver the just the initial part of it. If you could not achieve that within that sprint, you have to put it into the backlog, which means in the next sprint, you have to target that as a first item. When the new sprint comes, you need to take that as a first item and you need to work on. That's where this backlog comes. So sprint, we discussed about the dashboard. Dashboard is the place where we could see every developer or whomever is working on this project, what they are doing, since for everybody the task has been created. So in the dashboard, we could see a developer is working on a task for 40 hours. How many hours he has burnt it, how many hours he has worked on the task, how many hours it has left. If there is any problem or if he could not proceed with that particular task, you can put it into the blocking stage, or you can move it into a backlog, those things. So dashboard is a place it will give you an overview about, like, for a project managers, what exactly each team is does, like a testing team or product team or deployment team, etc. Then the next thing comes is like, so this is where the Azure board, the first service, is mainly talks about. So we could see, if possible, to see a real-time example. So as I said, like the Scrum and Kanban are the most methodologies which we have heard in Agile. That's where exactly Azure follows the most of the Kanban methodologies. The next thing comes is Azure Repo. Since we discussed in more detail about what is Azure Repo, Azure Repo is mainly using the Git repository, even if it's using the TFVC as well, the version control. But as you know, like, it's really outdated now, the entire world is more towards Git. You may heard of some of the projects or some of the terminologies called GitHub, GitLab, Bitbucket, etc. Let's see in more detail what is those things. So Git is the major source, guys. Like, without Git, we cannot do any code changes. Git is a repository. So on top of Git, we have a lot of UIs, like, you know, a lot of UIs to support on that. One is GitHub, which was delivered by the Microsoft. So GitHub is owned by Microsoft, and Bitbucket is owned by the Atlassian. Like, you know, the Confluence and Jira, like, those things are owned by Atlassians. They are hosting the Bitbucket. It's for a UI purpose. Again, I'm saying Git is the main thing. On top of the Git, for the UI functionalities or to make it a user friendly. So these are all the available tools, GitHub, GitLab, etc. So now Git, we are seeing here only the Git, not the GitHub, right? But Azure is using the GitHub. For our today's demo, we'll talk about more on Git, like what is exactly Git does. So Azure Repo has, again, five important things. One is files, commits. So file is nothing but each file is considered as a file you are committing into the Git repository. The next thing comes like Git commits. What does it mean by Git commits? Let's say I'm a developer, I'm working on something. I need to push that into a central repository, right? The central repository is nothing but Azure repository. Using commit commands, they will push the things into the repositories. Or using commit, they'll push it to the branch, and then followed by push is gonna push exactly into the repository. Branches, what is branch? Branches is nothing but in a Git way of working, we can have a n number of branches. If I want to give an example, if I want to compare with the previous one, we have something called sprint. Each sprint we are trying to achieve something, right? So what exactly the branches do? We have something called master branch. Master branch is the one who is going to have all the code. After that, we have created a branch called a release branch, or you can call it a sprint branch as well. So it represents the same. Each sprint is considered as one release for us, right? In Agile way of working. So we'll create that branch. Everybody will work on that branch and they will push. Once it has been successfully pushed, it would be merged to a master branch. So that's where this branches. We will see in more detail in our main classes, how this branch work or what all the branching strategies. We have a lot of labs from Amaya. Like, Amaya is having their own predefined labs where we can get all this hands-on exercise with the Amaya labs, how to achieve these branching strategies. Then the pull request, when the developer writes a work on something, the pull request mainly comes, a developer A has committed something, but he may be a new to the team, or he may not be a developer as well. He just started exploring the development. His code standards may not match the project standards, right? In that case, he will raise a pull request. So once he raises a pull request, it has to be approved by the either the development lead or the solution architect. Since what the developer is delivering something, is it a right one or wrong? Somebody has to review it. So that's where this pull request. We will see in more detail about all these things in our demo. We'll move on to the next service, the most important service in the Azure, which is Azure Pipeline. Guys, you could see over here. If you see this picture, it will talk about code. So developer does the code in the Git repo and he pushed it. Immediately what happened? He raised a pull request. So once, just now we saw what is pull request. So basically he is raising a request and it has to be approved by somebody, right? Once it has been approved, it has been merged to our main branch or release branch, right? Once it has been merged, so the commit has been made to the branch, the next thing comes, CI is coming. What is the CI? Continuous integration. So CI and CD are the most important things in the pipeline. So what CI does, what CD does, you could see it in this picture. CI is doing, first thing it's doing a building. Building, as I said, like automatically, we are taking the code from this repository and we are creating some var file or zip file or whatever it may be. That is called building the process, right? Once you have built it, you are deploying it in the test environment, or basically here we are targeting like a unit testing. So we are doing most of the unit testing here. Since development, our testing team would have given us the unit test cases, we would be doing the unit testing here, followed by, we have a lot of tools guys here. This is for SonarQube or Sonar Cloud. We will see in detail. We have a separate slides for this to discuss in detail. So Sonar Cloud, what does Sonar Cube does? See here, developer has pushed a change and it has been approved by dev lead. Still, there may be a chances the vulnerability in the code may come. The dev lead would have looked into a high level and he saw that, like, you know, the functionality works, so he pushed the change. But developer would have used multiple for loops, or which may go for an infinite loop. Those things has been captured by the third party tool called SonarQube, which would do a code smell. When we say a code smell, it would be keep smelling the code. If there is any bad things in the code, like, it will immediately block the pipeline and it will send an email to a developer who has checked in the code, saying like the code which he has pushed, which was not right. Please go and fix these things. So SonarQube will give us a suggestion, what went wrong, why it failed the pipeline, everything it has been given to the whoever has checked in the code, and also the dev lead who has reviewed that code. This is an automated process. Followed by that, we have a lot of third-party tools for security purpose also. WhiteSource is one of an example. So which can do SQL injection or like any kind of penetration testing. There may be like a lot of hackers in the world, right? The hackers may access our website and to do something. To block all those things, there were security tools which has been integrated in the pipeline, which will do those validations. So this is CI. So continuous integration, once again, I'm summarizing. So it's nothing but taking the code from the Git repo and building the var file, doing a unit testing and using some of the security tools and the code quality standard tools, it has been validated. So all this put together and we call it as CI, continuous integration. Followed by CD, continuous deployment. So we are doing a deployment in dev environment, QA environment, staging environment, and production environment. So if you see like in more detail, the below picture represents how exactly it works. So basically Azure boards has list of tasks. Developer has picked one of the tasks and he is using the Visual Studio, which is basically an IDE. Using this tool, he is developing the code and pushing the changes into the Git repository. Once he has pushed the changes, so automatically our Azure agent will take the code from the Git repo and doing a build. Once it has been built, how exactly it will do the build? So build job here, you could say. So it's getting the source code from here. Then tools, what are all the tools required for building? As I said, like if it's an Angular project, or like if it's in any front-end JavaScript project, we may be using NPM to build it. If it's a Java project, we use a Maven. If it's a .NET project, we may use NuGet. These are all the tools to just build the applications. So build solution, then followed by we are running the unit test, then packaging the artifacts. Now we could see something called artifacts, right? So what does this artifact represents? So the final outcome of the CI, which is basically the build file, right? The final outcome of the CI is basically what it's giving, the build file. That build var file is nothing but artifact. So you will go and keep that artifact over here. This artifact is why we are keeping it separately over here. This is for reusing it. Since, let me take a short break and tell you like a real-time example. Just imagine developer works on a project and he says like the things are working in his local, he deployed into the QA environment and he say like in QA environment also it's working, but the same code is going to production, it may not work. Why it will not work? Since we will be not sure which code they have taken it or which exactly which configuration they have taken it. So to avoid all those things, we are creating something called Azure Artifacts. So once it has been well tested and well certified, we would keep it in the artifacts. When we go for a next environment, when you go for a deployment, we will take it from here. So basically this Azure Artifacts, initially it got created from the developer machine and we kept it here, right? That WAR file has been created and it has been kept it here. Then we would be taking the same artifact and we are deploying into the development environment, which is like end-to-end testing for the developer, right? So it will be doing it here. Once this approval gates are crossed, then we will deploy the same artifact into the QA environment. Once it has been properly certified, we will deploy into the production environment. So here you could see something called staging. What does it mean, staging? Well, what is the difference between the production and staging? So if you want to take any code into a production environment, first it has to be staged or it has to be deployed in the staging environment and it has to be well tested and verified before we put it into production. Since none of the customer wants their application to be a downtime, right? Like let's say if there is a real-time application customer and if we are saying like we are deploying a new code and we need a 1 hour or 2 hour downtime, let's assume like yes, if they have agreed for it, then once we deploy the things are not working, how long it will take to revert it back, we never know, like all these things. So that's the purpose what the entire cloud has moved. Now they were talking a concept called a blue and green deployment. What does mean blue and green deployment? So we have a production environment and a production slot or a staging environment, right? So let's assume this is a blue and let's assume this is a green. So when a new package comes, like when you want to deploy something in this production, they will not directly deploy into this production. They will deploy the changes into the staging and they will well test the staging. If everything goes good, they will just swap this to a production and this will become a staging now. So they will go and deploy it here. If they want, they can still continue this as a production and this can be. So that is between the swap. So basically always the swap is happening between the staging environment and the production environment. In our real class, we will see in detail how to achieve blue and green deployment in detail in our lab environment. So we have a lot of labs in Ameya, so we could see like how to achieve all these features. I hope it's clear since it's one of the major features in the DevOps. I hope everybody understood what is CI/CD pipeline and how are we trying to achieve the CI/CD pipeline. If you have any question, feel free to always ping in the chat. We will take it at the end of the session. Next, we will see about the next service, which is our fourth service. Azure Artifacts. What is Azure Artifacts? We already seen in more detail. So using some of the build tools, we are creating the packages. The package is nothing but the, how does the package would be? It may be in a WAR file, zip file. So the end product of all these things is called Azure Artifacts. So these are all the most commonly used tools available in the market to build that packages. So NuGet is used to build the .NET codes. NPM is used to build all your JavaScript codes, like basically Node.js. And Python is used for using the Python scripts. And if all your Java scripts or Java codes are gonna use by Maven to build the packages. And the most important thing we could see is like here, Docker and Docker images. I don't want to go more detail here, like what is Docker and Docker images. Just bear with me in another couple of slides. We are going to touch in more detail about what does mean by Docker. So the next thing, when the next service we are going to talk about is the last service in our Azure, we are going to talk about is Azure Test Plans. So it's pretty straightforward. So here, like you could see a dashboard. The dashboard is going to show you like how many test cases you have executed, when you have executed, pass, fail percentage, everything you could see it over here. So again, guys, this is Azure DevOps. You could see, like, once you log into Azure DevOps, you could see like boards, repos, pipelines, test plans, artifacts. Everything is combined together in a single file. You could see all together in a single application. Let's move on to the next one. Now we have another question. So choose the clouds and clouds you love. Since it's not like Azure is not saying like you need to use everything with Azure. Let's say if the customer is more willing to use, or they are, have a good hands-on with some other boards framework, they can still use the different boards. But here you could see the first picture. They are going with Azure boards, Azure pipeline, but GitHub. This is they are using a GitHub and they are using Ansible. So it's basically like they can do a mix and match. So here they are using a Azure repo, test plans, Azure artifacts, but they are using Jenkins. They didn't use the pipeline. See, this is our Azure pipeline. Instead of using Azure pipeline, here they used Jenkins to automate the job. It's not only about the tools, it's also about the cloud. You can play around your clouds as well. You can come up with any cloud and you can use any one of the services as well. So that's where we are saying, like, you know, and not only about the cloud, even the on-premises also you can use it. So next we'll see about Sonar Cloud. We already seen about what is Sonar Cube. Sonar Cube is like, again, the code smelling technologies or the vulnerabilities. We could find it over here. Sonar Cloud is something like, it's mainly designed for the cloud related applications. So over there it does the same job of what Sonar Cube does. Finding up the vulnerabilities or the bugs or the code smell, it does all these things. And it will, as I said, like you could see more here, like more detail here, like some of the parameter use the developer forgot to instantiate, everything would be shown and the automated emails would be triggered to a developer to see it. Next, we could see the most important topic called containers. Or here is a place we could see like what is called Dockers. So before I talk about containers or Dockers, we need to see like what is virtual machine. So before we move to virtual machine, we need to see like what is on-premises. So if you imagine a olden days, like in the 1990s, so what will happen? Everything has been kept it in the your premises. So basically you have one data center. So data center is a place where you have all your hardwares and software installed and kept it over there. So that's called on-premises or nothing but a bare metal. People would be calling it as bare metal, which means everything is there on their local place. Next thing comes like a virtual machine. They don't want everything to be kept at some place. Let's say like I have my physical hardware sits in US. But the I have created a virtual machine which is using or which is consuming some of the hardware related things from that US office, but I'm hosting, but I can use this virtual machine in India. So that's where this virtual machine concept comes in. So what exactly does here? So at a high level, if you could see here, so this is your infrastructure, right? Like you have a server, you have a RAM, data space and everything. You have a host operating system also. So let's say you have created this, you have installed the operating system on your data center, Windows operating system. Now on top of that, you are creating one virtual machine. Let's say this is a 32 GB RAM. You know, here in the infrastructure, you have a 32 GB RAM. You are creating one virtual machine where you install the OS, where you are allocating 4 GB RAM here, 6 GB RAM here, or 8 GB RAM here, then 16 GB RAM here. So this basically, instead of using one premises, we have created three virtual machine now in this, right? So what virtual machine are? So here it's using one guest OS, which is having separate application is getting deployed here. It has app2 and all your binaries and libraries are installed as part of it. When I say like binaries and libraries, all your dependencies are installed in the virtual machine. So basically bare metal is nothing but your physical laptop virtual machine is nothing but inside your laptop, you are trying to access something as like a laptop, but it's not, but the physical things are not going to be with you. That's called a virtual machine. So you have a guest operating system has to be installed. So this is what serving the purpose until last couple of years back, the virtual machine was more hot in the market and every application or every project was using it. But now the world is more towards container. What is the drawback with the virtual machine? If you could see here, we are installing a OS here. Of course, we know like how long it will take to, what is the time process to install a OS and how much time the OS will consume. Sorry, how much memory the OS will consume. Everything matters. And there is no scalability here. Let's say while you are installing the, creating a virtual machine, you need to manually allocate a RAM here. Like, you know, you need to dedicatedly saying like you take 4 GB RAM and 200 GB hard disk, you take 6 GB RAM, 500 GB hard disk, something like that. You have to manually do all these things. But if you could see here with the containers, what is happening? It's same infrastructure, same operating system, but you don't have an operating system here in the image. So this one box is called as a virtual machine. So we have three virtual machine here. So here the this one box represents an image. So this and this is one image, this is one image, and this is third image. So here the main difference between the container and the virtual machine is, I would say container equal to container is nothing but virtual machine minus the guest OS is nothing but container. So only difference here is we have a guest OS. We don't have a guest OS here. So the main difference it was between these two is like you could see a comparison here. So this is heavyweight. Why we are calling this as heavyweight? Since it has the OS and all this, how much memory it's allocating for OS and all this things, but it's a lightweight. Just imagine to start up your local machine, it would nearly take 5 minutes, right? Like the same goes for a virtual machine also. The boot up time is always higher. But when you start a containerization or the Docker image, it's gonna be in a seconds. It will not even a minute. It's gonna start in a seconds. So that's the main feature or beauty behind the containerization. That's why the entire world is more moving towards the container. Who is supporting this container? Docker. There are a lot of other tools also available in the market. Who does the container, who is supporting the containers, but Docker is one of the prime players in that. So every application is using the Docker now, or every company is using the Docker now. So you could see more comparison here. I don't want to get into more detail. So this gives a high level overview like or difference between what is bare metal, virtual machine and the Docker. Next we could see like a Kubernetes, like one of the main things is called a Kubernetes. What is Kubernetes? In the previous slide, we have created a multiple containers, right? Like a basically multiple images we have created. Let's say your application is very huge and you need to deploy it in a multiple, or you have hundreds of deployment procedures you have, then you need to deploy in 100 different places. How are we going to do it, or is it I'm going to do it manually? No, that's where the Kubernetes comes into picture. To automate that deployment or to orchestrate that container part is going to be done by the Kubernetes. So it basically reduces the complexity of managing. You don't need to manage it. Again, the Kubernetes is an open third-party tool. It's an open source tool. What Azure has did, Azure has taken the Kubernetes and they have did a few customization or implementation, especially for Azure Kubernetes. So with that, they are trying to, you don't need to get into much detail about Kubernetes. So the application or Azure will take care of configuring all these things. Let's move on to the next one. The infrastructure and configuration support. So what we are trying to do here, you could see multiple tools called Chef, Puppet, Ansible, and Terraform. So these three tools are mainly for configuration tool, and this is for provisioning tool. Just imagine the organization could no longer afford to wait for hours or days for servers to be deployed, right? So everybody wants to be like, you know, it's to be super fast. So now what is happening, instead of doing all this deploy, all this setting up the server manually, even for that also it's been automated in a DevOps now. So the developer, whoever is like, even the developer is doing that, he's writing the code, infrastructure as a code and committing into the Git repository. So our basically what our agent does, like it will take that code from there and it will deploy in the cloud or it will deploy in the premises. So guys, like now Chef, Puppet and Ansible can be replaced by Docker. If you are using the Docker more extensively, these three tools can be replaced and with the Docker can also support it. But in some projects, people may use Docker and also any one of these tools, Ansible tools, mainly for playbooks to automate the things. And Terraform, which is really hot in the market, every cloud application is using the Terraform. So what is a Terraform? It's basically a provisioning tool which is going to manage the configuration related applications. Then we could see something called Azure Dashboard. So Azure Dashboard is a place where you could see everything on your application. So we have seen about a lot of services, a lot of things in bits and pieces now. With Azure Dashboard, everything is combined together and put it in a one place. Let's say if there is any issue comes in any part of the Azure application, the first thing the any guy like a developer or a tester or anybody who has to look is the Azure dashboard. Here they could see the real status of it. There is an issue, everything has been monitored here. This is always a customizable one. So the whoever is developing, the DevOps guy can customize this Azure dashboard. It's just an, everything is a configuration change. They don't need to really do any coding to achieve this. Then the last thing which are from, which we are going to discuss is rugged DevOps, or it's sometimes called as Dev Security Ops. So guys, world is moving more faster. So if you are trying to catch up DevOps, now the world is moving more towards that security ops. So we should be more faster enough to catch up the things. So the Dev Security Apps is exactly the same, but we have introduced a security layer for each and every part of the application. So with this, like, so basically here you could see develop DevOps, then security. It's called rugged DevOps. Then the next thing which we are going to see about demo, I think already we have taken like more than 1 hour or 1 hour 15 minutes. So we would be sending a URL for a demo. Like if you wish to, you can reach out to us with the email or any means. Like we would be sharing the demo links, what we have discussed so far. With this, I'll hand over to Ganeshan. Thanks a lot for attending this session.
Yeah, thanks Dinesh. Really, it's an so much mind-blowing and so much topics and everything. I hope everyone will appreciate this because DevOps is a wider area. As a base, it integrates three things: people, process, and the technology. So that is what the as much a simple way as any layman can able to understand that such a way Dinesh was presented. My sincere thanks to you.